Rosen for the Rosen Report, powered by the National Benefit Authority. And my guest now is Mike Wilner. How you doing, Mike?
Doing all right, sir. Thank you.
Great to have you on. A couple points about Mike. Mike was born March the 14th, 1970, correct?
True.
Mike is the voice of the Toronto Blue Jays and the host of their post-game show, which I love, Jays Talk, and we're going to get into that. And Mike has two daughters, which I'm sure are a handful. I have two daughters. My daughters are 32 and 28, so they're a touch older than your daughters. But
Uh-oh. What do we do? What'd I do? Oh, audio issue.
Continue or back from the beginning?
My crappy audio.
Daniel? Continue or back from the beginning? All right. Hello, this is Paul Rosen and the Rosen Report, powered by the National Benefit Authority. And my guest now is Mike Wilner. Mike, glad to have you on the show.
Thrilled to be here, Paul. Thank you.
Thank you. Mike was born March the 14th, 1970, correct?
Absolutely.
10 years younger than me. I was April 26th, 1960.
All right.
That's close. Mike is the voice of the Toronto Blue Jays and the host of the post-game show, Blue Jays Talk. We're going to talk about that. One of my favorite things to do driving home after umping a baseball game is to listen to Mike and how he handles the Blue Jay faithful crowd, or we'll say unfaithful at times crowd.
At times.
Mike has two daughters, and I have two daughters. My daughters are 32 and 28. I know, Mike, your daughters are a little younger.
Yeah, it's weird. You're only 10 years older than me, but my daughters are 18 years younger than yours. So you got started early. Mine are 14 and 10.
Yeah, I have two grandchildren, actually. I have a five-year-old grandson and a five-week-old grandson.
Amazing.
Yeah.
The heartiest of Mazel Tovs to you.
Thank you.
I have no grandchildren, thank
and,
God.
And yes, as a 14-year-old, and yes, I well, down the road, though.
Yeah.
It is the greatest thing in the world. To be a parent is even better to be a grandparent, because at the end of the day, you just send them home.
And before she gets too mad at me, I said 14 and 10. It's 14 and 11.
Oh, yeah, so yeah, you don't want to. What, their names?
Billy and Jillian.
I love those names.
They weren't supposed to rhyme. It kind of came out that way.
That's okay.
Yeah.
Nothing wrong with that. So, Mike, great career, and you know I'm a massive fan, and anybody out there that knows me, Paul Rosen, knows that I don't just say things to say things. I am a massive fan. How did you get into the career? Like, it was something that you thought about as a young kid? This is what you wanted to do?
Not really. I was kind of, I wouldn't say directionless, but I didn't know exactly what was going to happen. I thought that you would take, you know, the normal route. You go to school, then you go to university, and then you get a job. And whatever that job was going to be, I thought maybe I'd be an accountant. I thought maybe I'd be a lawyer. I didn't know. I went as far as to write the LSATs and did really well. But no, I kind of got drawn to it when I was in first year in university to the radio station. I thought, this looks kind of cool. You know, why not give it a shot? And through that, I wound up doing some sportscast, doing a little radio show, doing a Cable 10 show on, you know, cable access television. And that kind of moved into me looking to baseball. And after my first year of university, I found out where all the short season minor league teams were, the teams that you could work for, but it wouldn't pose a problem with going back to school the next year or you know, get in the way. The season started after school was over, middle of June.
So Gulf Coast League.
The Gulf Coast League doesn't broadcast really, but like the New York Penn League and the Northwest League and a couple of those, So I called every team that had every team in a short season league to say, here I am, I've done a little bit of radio, I've never done anything, but you know, and I got an answer from one team, and it was the Welland Pirates.
Okay.
And the guy said, look, give us a tape. Of what? I haven't done it, you know? So I remember I was at my grandparents' house, and I sat there with a tape recorder, watched the Blue Jays game, and I recorded a few innings, and I sent it to them, and the guy said, all right, look, you can come and be our second chair volunteer. We're not going to pay you. You do a couple of innings and whatever. We're doing 30 games. And I said, great. So that was awesome. And I went to do that for Welland in 1989. I was 19 years old. I did 30 games. Tim Wakefield was on that team, who later had a great career as a knuckleballer. He was the third baseman, who was awful. He hit 110. And then one game in August, he was on the mound, and he's like flipping these things up. We had no idea what was going on. And that 2 years later, he was like in the major leagues. So I did that. I came back, stayed in school, got my degree while I was still working for U of T. But I interned at the Fan for a summer. Covered the Jays games through U of T radio. I had a pass for the Blue Jays, but the Leafs wouldn't give us one, so we didn't do any hockey. And eventually just sort of, you know, worked my way here and there. In 1995, I wound up in New Britain, Connecticut, with the Hardware City Rock Cats as their pre- and post-game show guy. They were a double-A team, and the backup play-by-play guy. That was a very strange and weird situation. Before I left there, I was called to 680 News to audition for Peter Gross.
Okay.
Because he'd heard some of the stuff I did when I was at U of T, and some reports about it. It's such a long, convoluted story. But like, I was a public address announcer at U of T, and part of that job was calling wire services to tell them what the score was, right? Yeah. And so I called. At one point, they had me, okay, now call the radio station. So I called the Fan. And I talked to Tim Haffey, who was the CIUT, U of T radio sports director when I started there.
Okay.
And Haffey said to me, give me 30 seconds. So I did. And then the next weekend, I called the Fan and I said, you want 30 seconds? They said, sure. I called 680, you want 30 seconds? They said, sure. And Peter Gross from 680 called 2 days later to say, come audition. So while I'm in Hardware City, I get a call from Gross saying, we have a job. It actually pays money. This one did not.
Right.
Right. I didn't have to also engineer the broadcast, which I had no idea how to do.
Right.
And it was, you know, in Toronto, right? So I said, okay, thank you, New Britain, back to Toronto.
Gotta leave.
Right. And then 6 years later, Scott Ferguson, who was the Blue Jays' me, basically, he left the Fan to go to follow the Blue Jays to headline Sports Radio Network, where the Jays had gone for a few years.
Right.
And I got a phone call at 680 from Scott Metcalf, who was the news director at the Fan, who said, hey, we remember you interned here 8 years ago and you really liked baseball. Yeah. Did you want to come do the Blue Jays?
No, yeah, I don't want to.
Right, exactly. So then that's, and then the next year the Jays were back on the Fan because Rogers bought them and bought us. And,
right.
And that's, the rest is history. It's a long history, but that's the history.
But you know what? It's a great history because it shows everybody out there to follow their dream, and perseverance is number one. Like, I'm sure you had a lot of doors shut on you, but what Mike said he did, and I've been fortunate to do the same thing because you have that strong will and probably that strong upbringing, whether it was your parents or grandparents, like I had also, to just keep trying and keep phoning and phoning and phoning. And a lot of kids now, they settle for mediocrity and they don't try to push themselves to get that one person to give them that break. And I've got a lot of respect for that, that you did. Before we get into talking about baseball now, I had a hello from a buddy of mine who's been on the show, Dan Berlin. And sure. I know Dan thinks very highly of you.
And did some work think together. Likewise. Yeah, he's an ex-sportsnetter.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, he said to say hi to you. Baseball. I got to tell everybody. Anybody that knows me, I know I made my living playing hockey for Canada for a number of years, but baseball's my number one sport. My brother, who is 4 years older than me, he took me before the Jays were a team. We would drive to Montreal to see the Expos play.
Wow.
My favorite player of all time, I loved right fielders. Ellis Valentine was my favorite. He had a cannon arm. I loved outfields that could gun the guy from right field to third base. That play's almost gone in baseball, but I absolutely loved it. So I want to ask you a question now, somebody who's been around the game and sees every team pretty well. I loved old school baseball. Not that I don't love baseball now, but I loved when somebody did something back then, you paid the price. There's too many guys out there now, prima donnas, making a ton of money that, you know, they have this I expect it. Everything is given to everything. I expect everything to be given to me. You know, I'm going to do this. I'm going to throw this. I'm going to talk. I'm going to talk to the umpire. Does at a certain point, does it not drive you crazy? Are you an old school guy, or do you see the greatness in the game now?
I'm sort of in the middle.
Okay.
I appreciate all the old traditions, and I, you know, I love the history of the game and all that wonderful stuff. But I believe that it's okay to, you know, celebrate your accomplishments.
I have no problem with that.
So, well, like if you pimp a home run or something like that, right, that's totally fine with me. Yep. If you don't want a guy to do that, get him out.
Yep.
And I also think that umpires have it really tough, and it's too bad. And I know talking to a guy who is an umpire, and I have friends who are umpires too, not major league umpires or anything, but it's an impossible task to ask a human being to be correct in calling balls and strikes when pitches are moving in the high 90s and with this amazing tilt and sink and whatever. How do you do that? So I do believe that Jose Bautista, for example, knows the strike zone a lot better than a lot of the guys calling balls and strikes behind him.
I agree with you.
Right? And he's said, he's an interesting dude. You know, but he's come out and said, look, I don't believe that somebody else's mediocrity should be allowed to affect my performance. Yeah. And he's exactly right.
Yeah.
So I'm in favor of having an electronic strike zone, because it's too much to ask,
right,
for people to get it right, right? So that's the kind of stuff that I like. The prima donna stuff, I think, is less the player's fault than the system's fault.
Okay.
Because guys are moved up so quickly, and they do have everything handed to them. And when you start to be told at 12 years old how great you are and how much money you're going to make, and you know, Bryce Harper was on the cover of Sports Illustrated at 16 with the headline, "This guy's going to the Hall of Fame."
Yeah, he hadn't even played a game.
Yeah, hadn't even been drafted. It's ridiculous. But that's the system that we're building. And I think it's because also of the 24-hour sports cycle, and the news is on all the time. And so you have to come up with something to talk about. So, hey, let's find a great 14-year-old. And, you know, so it's unfortunate, but it leads to this entitlement. But it's only there because they actually get it.
Right.
Right. So as far as old school versus new school, I like celebration. I like bat flips. I'm of the mind that if you don't want someone to celebrate, get them out.
Yeah.
Right? And plain and simple. Like if in the football, with everyone was all upset about Cam Newton and his touchdown celebrations,
right,
keep him out of the end zone and he won't celebrate.
Yeah.
Right?
Pretty straightforward.
Yeah.
So you get a chance now to go to parks. I would think you've been to, if not all, the parks.
I think there are about 8 that I haven't been to.
Okay.
Including, though, Wrigley Field and Dodger Stadium are still on my list.
Really? You haven't been to Wrigley or Dodgers?
No.
Wow.
I know.
So let's take Wrigley and Dodger Stadium out of it. What's the most fan-friendly park that you've been to?
That's interesting, because that's an experience that I don't get, right? Because
right.
I'm never down in the trenches with
but
the
But I'm
fans.
Sure a lot of people come and talk to you. And
yeah. I think people love Fenway Park for the history of it, right? You know, you walk in there and, hey, Ty Cobb played here, Babe Ruth, and all this stuff. I know Jeff Blair, who I work with on The Fan, refers to it as the world's largest urinal.
Well, and you know what? I had an opportunity. I don't know how many people know this, but in 2008, they did a documentary on our team called Sledhead, and the World Championships culminated in Boston. We ended up beating the Americans 3-2. The gentleman who did the documentary, I was a big part of the documentary, very, very honored to be that, but he knew how big the Red Sox were. They had won the World Series before. The day that we won the gold medal in Boston was April the 6th.
Okay.
So April 7th, they were opening up the new season. The gentleman, Dave McGilvery, ended up taking me as a surprise the next morning to Fenway Park, had the whole thing set up. They had the banner. They were getting ready to put everything out for rehearsal. And they took me. I'll never forget this as long as I live. And I had an opportunity to meet Dwight Evans and Carlton Fisk and some of the best Red Sox back in the day in the 70s. And he took me inside the wall, inside the monster. It was one of the most incredible experiences. People that don't like sports are going to look at me and think, oh my God, you're nuts, man. The guy's 56. He's going. But inside that, and I can understand where Jeff said to you, it's like from 1912. Yeah. You're whacking your head. There's scratches all over. People have signed their names. Some of the best players in the world. It blew me away.
Yeah, I've been to Fenway a bunch of times. I've never been inside the wall. I need to do that.
You have to do it. Yeah. You have to be very careful, though, because you will smash your head. There's so many different crevices and nooks. You were talking about Wrigley, that you haven't been there. The Cubs. Is this their year?
I can't. Can it ever? No, they're never going to win a World Series. Like, they're going to go
200
years.
That's what people said about the Red Sox, and they've won three in the last
year. Yeah, it's true. But there's got to be some lovable loser. I mean, the Cubs are a phenomenal team. They really are. They've done it really well. Theo Epstein came over there after he turned Boston, and he's turned this team around, and it's talented. I mean, they're playing so far over their heads that it's insane. But then you look at the numbers, and when you go deep, like the Pythagorean win-loss record for them is, they've underachieved based on their run differential, which is crazy. But I can't imagine there's any way the second half of the season goes the way the first half of the season did. And then the thing is, the way the playoffs are, right? If you win your division, I firmly believe you have a 1 in 8 chance of winning the World Series. It doesn't matter how good a team you are, no matter who you're playing, doesn't matter anything, you have a 1 in 8 chance of winning the World Series, and that's it. Because the things that make you great over 162, which are the things that really matter, because 162 games, you know, is what matters. They have nothing to do with winning a best-of-5 series. Nothing at all, right? It's a coin flip. So I would love to see the Cubs win. It would be great. I mean, to see a team that hasn't won since 1908.
Cubs and the Jays in the World Series.
How horrible would that be, though? Because nobody on earth would be rooting for the Blue Jays.
That's true.
You'd be these big villains, right?
That would be better.
Then
I'd get to go to Wrigley. Because you're going in as the underdog.
At least I would get to see Wrigley that way.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah, I think if the Blue Jays beat the Cubs, they would be even more hated universally than they are right now across.
Yeah, it's very possible. Yeah. It's Paul Rosen for the Rosen Report, powered by National Benefit Authority. We'll be back after these messages.
The National Benefit Authority helps people with disabilities receive the disability tax credit from the Canadian government. We navigate all obstacles with you to determine your eligibility and position you best for a successful 10-year retroactive claim, and receive up to $20,000 for an adult and $50,000 for a child.
The National Benefit Authority went back 10 years and got me money I didn't even know was mine.
Get the money you deserve. Call us at 1-855-456-6688.
Let me ask you, I'm going to go in another direction, and I hope you can answer this question. Manage, in my opinion, a lot of people say to me, and you know, managers don't mean as much as people think they do. Coaches don't mean. I had some great coaches over the years, and I don't think we win the gold medal in Torino without the coach that we had, Jeff Snyder. Top three managers in baseball, in your opinion?
Wow. John Gibbons is the only one I see every day, right? I know Joe Maddon has a wonderful reputation. I know Buck Showalter considers himself to be a genius.
Just by the records in the team,
but you can't go by record, right? Because they go up and down,
let me ask you a different question. You are a ball player.
Okay.
In the 30 managers in the major leagues right now, who's the guy you want as your manager? Let me ask you that one.
I mean, I don't think you can go wrong with Joe Maddon. I think Bruce Bochy, John Gibbons, players love. Yeah. And, you know, I think what you need is, you need a guy who's not going to get in the way, right? Yeah. You need someone who's a good tactician, who is going to create the right atmosphere, right? It's about, you know, coaching is different than managing, I think. And there's a reason that in baseball they're called managers, and in hockey, football, basketball, they're called coaches,
right?
Because in baseball, a manager can only manage.
Right.
You go and I'm going to put this guy in the position where I think he's likeliest to succeed,
right?
And then it's up to him. Motivation doesn't matter in baseball. You can't win a battle in the corners in baseball. You can't take the ball away from somebody else. You get your turn, they get their turn, all that stuff, right? So I want a guy who tactically knows what he's doing and who isn't going to make the whole clubhouse hate him.
Right.
And that's, you know, that's all you need.
And a lot of people, I don't get it because I like Gibbons, but a lot of people, I don't think he gets the just rewards. I don't think people, you know, give him the credit that he deserves.
I don't think they do either, but there are a few reasons for that, right? He's still attached to J.P. Ricciardi a little bit,
right?
Because that's how he came in. He is very happy to let you think he's just some dumb hick,
right?
Right, and yeah. I think that fans, a lot of fans, do think that. Right? But it's also the narratives that people create, because you can have the exact same behavior from two different people, exact same with different results. And you'll read completely different things into that.
Right.
John Gibbons sits in the dugout, right? He is, for the most part, dispassionate, sits there, watches a game go, and runs the game. And people say he doesn't care, he's lazy,
right.
He's stupid. Tito Gaston, sat in the dugout, did nothing, never got up and paced, never got up and screamed. You know, the exact same behavior in the dugout as John Gibbons. Exact, but he was calm, and he was relaxed. He knew what he was doing.
Right.
So it depends on what you think of people, and you look at the exact same behavior, you come up with two different...
Perception.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. Let me ask you a question that a lot of people, when I'm around baseball, they always ask, and it's something that I don't think it's really explained properly, and I've heard you on the radio many times explain it perfectly. So when people say Rule 5, what exactly is a Rule 5 situation?
The Rule 5, it's a draft that's every December. The way it works is it was originally put in to avoid having teams hoard talent, right? It used to be that once you have a guy in your system, if you took him from high school, you have 4 years to put him on your 40-man roster. Teams have, you know, 6 or 7 minor league teams, so there are hundreds of players in an organization. But there's a 40-man roster, and there's the active roster of 25. So 25 guys play in the big leagues, but you have 40 who you can move up and down and all that stuff. And once you're on the 40-man roster, you have your options start. So you have 3 years of options, and then you're out of options, and you have to either play or you have to be exposed to waivers or somebody else. So that's one way of avoiding hoarding talent, right?
Right.
So prior to the last, like, 4 or 5 years, I don't know when the rule changed, but... Once you had a guy, if you had him out of high school, 4 years till you have to put him on the 40-man roster. If you draft him out of college, 3 years until you have to put him on the 40-man roster. And if you don't, then they become eligible for the Rule 5 draft. Now it's 5 years for high school, 4 years for college. So say you draft a guy, pardon me, in 2011, you draft a guy out of college. He hasn't made it onto your 40-man roster yet, so he can't sort of start that system of, hey, in 3 years, I'm going to be in the big leagues or have an opportunity.
Right.
Right? And you don't want to put him on the 40-man. That means anybody can grab him in the Rule 5 draft. So the Rule 5 draft happens at the end of the winter meetings. And if a player is selected in that draft, he has to be on your big league team all year.
Can't hide him. He's
right.
There.
He's there all year. I mean, they hide him. They make up injuries, whatever. They, you know, phantom disabled this stuff. But it doesn't happen a lot. But you have to be on the major league roster all season or be offered back to the team that you took him from,
right,
for half the draft cost, which is like it costs you $50,000 to draft him. You have to offer him back for $25,000 if you're not going to keep him. So the Blue Jays used it on Joe Biagini. But they, you know, George Bell was a Rule 5er. Kelly Gruber was a
There's
Rule 5er.
There's some great ones over the years.
Manny Lee was a Rule 5er. Roberto Clemente was a Rule 5er, right? So so it's a neat little thing. We don't see it work a lot, but the stories are pretty nice when it does.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
It's kind of that Cinderella story.
Yeah.
Last question before we get into some of our little fun things here. Best ball player you ever saw?
Wow. On a regular basis, probably Roberto Alomar. But I didn't, you know, I was more of a fan then. For the 5 years that Alomar was a Blue Jay, I only covered the team for two of those years. But he was just incredible. So on a regular routine basis, Roy Halladay, Carlos Delgado was an amazing, amazing ball player. Jose Bautista is something else, right? So we've been fortunate to have a lot of really terrific players that I've gotten to see a lot.
Not a lot of 5'2" players over the years, eh? Very, very rarely.
Alomar was one, yeah, right?
He could do it all.
Sean Green, I think, when he was at his peak, was another. Delgado couldn't steal bases, yeah. Bautista's is pretty close to a, and Josh Donaldson's pretty close to a 5-tool guy. Now, Donaldson plays defense. He hits for average. He hits for power. He can run. I don't think he's been caught stealing in like his last 40 attempts.
Wow.
He just doesn't run that much.
Yeah. Great
and
arm.
He can throw, yeah.
Yeah.
And you loved great right field. I mean, Jesse Barfield was right
one
there, right? Yeah. And the Blue
White
Jays
Evans,
had Mark
Barfield.
Whitten for a couple of years, and he threw better than anybody I've ever seen.
Cannons.
Yeah.
I love that cannon. I love that old school. It just brings back so many memories with, you know, going to the Expos and seeing Rusty Staub and Ellis Valentine and just some of the greats. Although you give me the opportunity to go to a Jays game and I'm there in a heartbeat.
Yeah.
I used to love just sitting there by myself and scoring a game. The art
nice.
Of scoring a game.
Yeah. Geddy Lee does that too,
yeah,
right? You'll see him sitting there by himself scoring a game.
It's just baseball. Brings your child. That's the one thing about baseball. It just brings your childhood back. I don't know. I love it. And I love talking to you, Mike. I could talk to you for hours. Mike's been a fantastic guest. If you have the opportunity and the game is over and you want to listen to some great, well, during the game, you want to listen to Mike also. He's fantastic. But if you want to listen to some great, interesting, controversial, at times, I don't know how you do it because I think I would throw my radio or my microphone against the wall and talk to people who think they know a lot about baseball until they talk to you, Mike, on Jays Talk. After every single game, you're on 162 post games.
Mostly.
Like some
weekday
preempted
day games or whatever we don't do. But yeah, most of the time, yeah.
150, let's
sure,
say.
Let's
easy.
Say 155
easy.
Maybe.
Yeah. And hopefully next year anybody at Rogers, you know, if you're watching the Rosen Report, I appreciate it. But if you're watching the Rosen Report, I want this guy on doing play-by-play on the radio more often. I love listening to the radio, and I love listening to Mike Wilner. This has been the Rosen Report. Paul Rosen, I appreciate everything. Mike, one last question. Mike Wilner, sitting on the couch here, if you had the opportunity to talk to 15-year-old Mike Wilner, knowing what you know now, what would you tell him?
That's really loaded.
Yes.
I don't know, because things seem to have worked out. You know, like I took a very untraditional route to get where where I am right now and hopefully where I'm heading. And I don't know that... I mean, I'm sure I made mistakes along the way and I screwed things up, whatever, but it wound up getting me here. You know, like maybe I would tell myself, hey, when you intern at the Fan in 1993, maybe stick with it a little harder. Don't feel like you're entitled to be on the air because you did 4 years at U of T.
Right.
But that's what got me here, right? Maybe it took a little longer, maybe not. I don't know. Career-wise, it's definitely been a circuitous route, but it wound up in the right place. You know, personal stuff-wise, relationshipy things, there are things everyone wants to do differently. But again, you know, I sit here divorced, which is the last thing I wanted to be, but I have two incredible children out of this.
Right.
So it's not, don't do that, because look at the result, right? I see it more as a brief rather than a failed marriage, you know? It worked well, but it didn't work well for a long time. So what am I going to tell my 15-year-old self about that,
yep.
Right? If I had, you know, could go back 30 years, I would say, you might want to invest in some tech startups. Put your money in Apple.
Yeah. Good good advice, especially relationship advice. I love that. That's from a guy who's divorced also. That's good to know. Mike, you have your seatbelt. Your seatbelt's there. You ready to strap
in? I hear we're going rapid
strap in.
Fire.
We're going rapid fire right now. It's my favorite time on the Rosen Report here with Paul Rosen and Mike Wilner, powered by the National Benefit Authority. Favorite movie?
Oh, God. Too many to list, so I'll just pander and say Major League.
Okay, good one. Favorite restaurant?
Well, I met my current ex-wife at Lime Ricky's. Which
I
is
loved,
dead
you know
now.
What?
Really,
I loved
you?
Lime Ricky's. I really did. They had a seafood chowder there. that I'm a big soup guy.
All right.
That I just love soup. Talking about soup, I became a soup. I know we're off rapid fire.
Always but happy to talk about
that's
soup.
That's me. My grandmother, who was one of the greatest people in the world, this chest here was my grandmother's. She came over from the Ukraine when she was 15 years old, and she made me soup and my brother and sister soup continuously. We only had one rule. You couldn't ask her what was in the soup.
Really?
But I love soup, and there was a great soup at Limerick's. Okay, let's get back. Name of your first pet.
Never had a pet. I'm not a pet.
Really?
I had a goldfish when I was 6 that I
killed.
All
right, what was the name?
I have no idea.
Okay. All right. You're the first guest to say that, but that's cool. First car.
First car was a 1997, which is late, right?
Yeah.
A Pontiac Sunfire. I needed a car because I got a job with the Watertown Indians in the New York Penn League.
Okay.
I would broadcast Monday night games for them. Like they didn't want to do a full schedule. So it was right. Monday night football. Well, let's do Monday night baseball with the Watertown Indians. And I thought, oh, all right, I'm going to need to figure out a way to get to Watertown once a week.
Yeah.
So I had to finally buy a car. I had been a TTC guy through school and through work and everything. But that was it. 97 Pontiac Sunfire.
Okay.
Yeah. Served me well.
You definitely weren't going to spend the week in Watertown. Not a chance. Favorite band?
For legitimacy purposes, I will say Rush. Guilty pleasure purposes, Duran Duran.
Yeah, there's nothing wrong with that. This is, hey, the Rosen Report, there's no judging on the Rosen Report.
You
say what you want, do what you want. Wasn't that say what you want, do what you want? Well, that was a song. Say what you want, do something like that.
That's one thing.
One thing leads to another
by the Fix.
Hey. Useless music trivia with Mike Wilner and Paul Rosen on the Rosen Report.
Say what they need.
Okay, all right.
But that's
You probably got a little more that it sparked that.
Well,
there you go. Yeah. Favorite country?
Canada.
Okay. Favorite city?
Toronto.
Okay. Same with me, but you never know.
Absolutely. I've lived here my whole life except for the 6 weeks in New Britain, Connecticut.
Oh. All right. And I've lived here my whole life. Favorite food?
Anything that is terrible for you. I think, as you can see from my current physique, I'm not someone who takes very good care of what I put in my mouth, which has to stop, I think. But that's a whole other story. I have an extraordinarily undeveloped palate. So I have the tastes of an 8-year-old.
Okay.
And so give me, you know, crappy comfort food will work every time. Big fan of soup too. I enjoy a good soup.
Yeah. When I retired, I said I would never have that retired body after I retired from playing because you're training 6 days a week. I have the retired body now, and I do not eat salad or celery. I love bacon and hamburgers and anything that's bad for you. I love.
Yeah.
Favorites, I know where this is going to go, but favorite sport?
That's always been baseball, like from the beginning, to play, to watch. Now, I broadcast hockey in university, and I loved it. Hockey is so much fun to call.
Yeah.
And I love to play. You know, I met you covering the sledge hockey thing that led to...
That was a long time ago.
Yeah, it was in 2002. It led to me being asked to play in the Team Canada 72 alumni game in Brantford, which is the greatest athletic moment of my life. I mean, it's amazing that baseball has been so much for me.
Right.
But if you ask me the greatest moment of my life, it was stopping Paul Henderson on a penalty shot.
No way.
Yeah.
And I never knew that.
I was the only one in the rink who wanted that puck out of the net. But, I mean, that was... And I had to retire from hockey like... a year or two later, because I have this neck injury, so I'm not allowed to play contact sports. But but that was an amazing, amazing moment.
Wow.
Yeah.
That was incredible. You know what? I'm going to go, because most people think hockey for me, and we're going to go a little bit off the beaten track, because I don't know if you know this story, but baseball has been a huge, huge, huge part of my life. And my favorite moment, and people say you're insane, but I think you'll like this. So the Boston Red Sox are my favorite team. They have been. Well, I love the Jays now, but I followed the Red Sox from 71. There was no Jays team. So we go in 75, the winter or spring training after the Carlton Fisk, with the losing to the Big Red Machine in Cincinnati. So we're in Florida, my mother, my father, my sister, and my brother. My brother's 4 years older than me. I'm 15, he's 19. We take the car, we convince my parents we're gonna go to Winter Haven.
Horrible place.
Brutal. So we're gonna see the Boston Red Sox, went to the World Series, and we're gonna see them in a spring training game against the Detroit Tigers.
Okay.
So we get there. I had a glove that I bought maybe a few months before, and it was a Bernie Carbo. For those of you who don't know who Bernie Carbo is, Google it.
Yeah.
We're not going to get into Bernie Carbo 100% here, but so I get this Bernie Carbo glove. We're watching the game. I kind of have a big mouth, 15-year-old. My brother's very shy, 19-year-old. The game ends. I want to get this glove autographed. I want to get some stuff. We're waiting at the end. Louis Tiant walks by me. Got George Scott. It's just great names. Carlton Fisk and Freddie Lynn. And so I'm getting some autographs on the glove. Bernie Carbo walks out. I swear to God, on anybody that loves life, I'm out there in the parking lot. Bernie Carbo walks by and he looks at the glove and he takes the glove from me. And I'm like, what the hell's going on here? And Bernie Carbo takes my glove. He thinks I stole his glove. I think, are you insane? Mike Torres steps in, stops a fight between Bernie Carbo and a 15-year-old punk from Toronto, Paul Rosen. And he goes, Bernie, relax, man. Let's go back to the clubhouse. So goes back to the clubhouse, realizes that glove is not his glove. It's my glove. Apologizes, takes the glove, and gets it signed by the entire team. I got Jerry Remy on there. I've got Carl Yastrzemski, the Yaz Man. I've got Freddie Lynn. I've got George Rice. It was insane. I still got the glove. Unbelievable. So that's just from, you know, people thinking crazy stories, crazy. That's a crazy story. The Paul Henderson story, I love it. That's a crazy story. I'm going to end on one serious note. Mike, if you could change one thing in the world, what would it be?
That's, again, incredibly loaded question, right? And the obvious answer is, hey, world peace. Let's have that. And I think that, I don't know if that's something that's specifically changeable.
Right.
I would like intelligence and, you know, reason to be seen as good things again. I think that the world, at least our part of the world, the Western world, has devolved over the last 20 or 30 years. And maybe this is the way everybody feels as they age, right? But I think that used to be like smart was valued. And I don't think it is anymore. I think we're moving very quickly into an idiocracy where it doesn't, you know, where brains are looked down upon, where I have a right to my opinion is the thing that means more to anybody than anything. And people don't understand that, you know, you have to actually be informed about things. We just saw the vote in Britain, right? To leave the EU, where people came back and regretted it, saying the next day it's like, oh, I can't believe I voted that way, or oh, I didn't think my vote would count. You know, how dumb are you? Just get informed and do it. I have people, and it comes back to my experience, right? People call in to Blue Jays Talk all the time with these opinions that are informed by nothing.
Right.
But even when they're told about, well, this is what's really happening, they'll still stick to, no, I'm going to believe what I believe.
Yeah.
And I think that a lot of it is because of, again, I blame the 24-hour news cycle. I blame CNN for this because they say, well, we need to give equal time to both sides of the story, even if one side is a complete lunatic,
yes,
who has no idea, but they're going to get equal time and their views are going to be treated as sane and they're going to be unchallenged. But this is this side and this is this side, and we'll let the viewers decide instead of saying, this guy's a moron,
right,
who has no idea what he's saying,
right,
and this is what's really happening in the world.
Yeah.
So I think people need to start looking at things with a critical eye, listening to things with a critical ear, understanding that their role in making the world a good place is important. And you can't just accept lunacy because it happens to be in conflict with another side.
Yeah. enough stupidity. Like, there's enough stupidity in the world. That's one of the million things I love about this show, is somebody will call in and they'll go, hey, Mike, how you doing? I love the show. Hey, listen, Batista did this and he did that. And you go, no, actually, he didn't. And he goes, yeah, he did. No, actually, he didn't. I have everything in front of me. This is what he did. And you are 100% wrong. And I love it. And they'll argue with you that they're right when they're totally wrong.
When I you know, I told you I did the Welland Pirates in 1989. And when I drove home from those games, I would turn on Jay's Talk.
Right.
Whoever was hosting. You know, it didn't matter at the time. But I would listen to that. And there would be a lot of times where a caller would call in and present, this is my thesis. This is what I think is happening. And whether it's right or whether it's completely wrong, the host goes, uh-huh, and they continue,
right?
And that happens all the time on all kinds of talk radio shows, on all kinds of whatever, and even stuff that's important, like news programming, right? Present your case, okay, and you go on. And I thought, how can you leave that unchallenged? And for me, you know, the everyone is entitled to their own opinion, but no one's entitled to their own facts, right? And if you have your opinion, you have to be able to back it up. You can't just think something because you think that. And if you call, like, my show, my little tiny bastion of whatever, you're going to be challenged on your opinions. And if you can back it up, fantastic.
Yeah.
If you can't, you're going to find out about it.
Absolutely. And that's about, when I started doing the color for CBC and for TSN with the sledge hockey, Don Cherry said something to me that meant the world before I started it. And he said, be as controversial as you want. Say whatever you want, but be able to back it up.
Right.
You want to call Sidney Crosby a terrible hockey player? That's stupidity, because he's not. You want to say something that you can back up? And I love it. And I'm still doing it now. So obviously they understand that I know a little bit about what I'm talking about.
Absolutely.
So, Mike, this has been fantastic. The Rosen Report, Paul Rosen, powered by the National Benefit Authority. Until next time.